Hey YouTubers, it's Mike from MikeTech12. You know, a few months ago I was thinking to myself, what would make the perfect phone? It would need to feel premium, have an excellent camera, have front-firing speakers, a quick processor, and be affordable. Not long after, Google announced their flagship phone, the Nexus 6P, and it felt as though all my desires had been fulfilled. Let's go ahead and take a look at it and see if you should pick it up. Google ditched Motorola and has teamed up with Huawei to bring us their new flagship for 2015. Most US buyers have never heard of this phone brand before, but it's actually a pretty successful device manufacturer overseas. The Huawei Nexus 6P is built with an aluminum body, with the front screen being an AMOLED panel supported by Gorilla Glass 4. There is a certain sense of reassurance that if I drop this phone, it'll be okay. The Note 5 is the reigning king of phablets, and I don't get that same feeling when I hold onto that device. It may be thinner and easier to hold, but it's slippery, and I always feel as though I need to hold it with two hands so nothing happens to it. The size of the screen on the Nexus 6P is 5.7 inches, down from the 5.9 inches of last year's Motorola-built handset. Honestly, that's a good thing, as last year's Nexus felt way too big. This one almost feels like a blown-up HTC One with its slightly curved sides. Last year's actually felt like a small tablet disguised as a phone, versus it being a true phablet. It really didn't feel like a device that could justify its $650 price tag. This year, all of that is different. It's not just slightly smaller screen, the bezels are slightly smaller than with the 6P, and it has a really solid feel. Buttons are really solid and tactile. The placement of the power key is perfect. The volume keys get in the way of where I normally place my hand, and I find myself accidentally clicking them from time to time. But I'm sure that after more time with the device, I'll get over that. The blogosphere has been buzzing about the camera hump on the top of the device. From earlier leaked photos, it seemed like it was really out of place. But in person, it works really well. It makes a slightly curved device be able to sit flat on a table, unlike some of the competition. Like other aluminum devices, there are some traces of the phone antenna on the shell, but they really aren't that intrusive. Three colors are offered on this year's Nexus flagship. That includes black, white, and the silver that I have here. I opted for the silver because I think it provided the most unique and premium look. On the top of the device is a 3.5mm headset jack, while only thing found on the bottom is the new USB Type-C power input. On the back of the device is the now trademark Nexus logo, as well as a fingerprint reader. The positioning takes some time to get used to, but after a day or two, it becomes second nature. It really is awesome in its functionality. You don't even have to wake the device before using it. Place your finger on the fingerprint reader and locks the device, and it's super quick. I think it's just as quick as the newest Apple fingerprint reader, but there's nothing to push down. Just slide your finger in place and watch the magic happen. I have to admit, I'm not that impressed with the display on this device. The colors aren't as great as something like the Note 5 or the LG V10. They're slightly darker in tone, and they don't seem as lifelike. It's not a deal breaker when viewing it on its own, it's just one of those things you wish could have been better. I'm not too happy about the brightness of the screen either. I was watching a movie in a well-lit room, and I thought I would turn the brightness up to see how it would look, but it turns out I already had the brightness all the way up. It's just sort of dim and dull. Viewing angles, especially in the sun, suffer because of this. It's not the worst display I've seen, but you'll definitely drain your battery trying to see clearly. Visually, not a whole lot has changed from Lollipop to Marshmallow, but it seems to work in perfect harmony now. It's not just faster, it's smooth. I can speed up animations and make a phone perform a bit faster, but that's not what this is. This is Android finally being as smooth as iOS. Android has always lagged behind iOS, because it felt like the software was altered to work with the hardware. iOS feels like the software was designed to work specifically for the hardware, and that's now what this feels like. The app drawer for the Google launcher is now vertically scrolling, and there's a helpful section that shows recently used apps. App permissions are a huge part of this OS. It feels like every time I open an app, it's asking me to allow blah blah blah. This is huge to me because one of the main reasons I root a phone is to be able to have full control over the permissions an app may have. Google Now has been updated as well, and it's more helpful than ever. You're now able to get more relevant cards and suggestions based on your location and location history. But the biggest new feature that Marshmallow brings us has to be Now on Tap. Now on Tap allows Google to look at the content on your screen and make helpful suggestions based on what it finds. Talking to a friend about tickets to get a new movie? Use Now on Tap and Google will find showtimes and information about the movie and actors. Or maybe you're discussing through text what you're going to have for Thanksgiving dinner. Use Now on Tap and you'll be given more information about that particular dish as well as recipes. At least that's the way it's supposed to work. Whether or not it actually works like that seems to be a coin toss. Sometimes the feature works perfectly. Other times it's unable to pull any useful information. Once Now on Tap matures through a few software updates, it'll be a killer feature. But right now it's clearly in its infancy and almost feels as though it should have remained in beta testing. I'll keep hope alive for now. The camera is a feature on Nexus devices that we've come to expect will be poor. Nobody buys a Nexus handset for its amazing camera, but this year is a little different. The megapixel count is down from last year's Nexus, but the quality is definitely improved. There's now a 12 megapixel shooter with a larger than normal pixel size. These larger pixels absorb more light, so even though there aren't as many megapixels as some of the competitors, you might notice photos looking slightly better. I have to admit, the photos taken are pretty good, not just for a Nexus, but in general. It's not the greatest on the market, but it's definitely in the top 5. There is a quick open feature that allows you to quickly access the camera by double-clicking the power button with the screen on or off. The implementation of it is just as good as Samsung on their S6 and Note 5 devices, but I think the power button is a better place to access it than the home button. Shutter speed is very quick, and focus time is very good as well. It has the same type of laser-guided autofocus found on LG phones, and it works just as well here. I'm able to snap off some pretty good photos of still or slowly moving objects. Trying to take photos of videos of my kids hasn't proven to be so easy, and I think that's where you really notice the lack of optical image stabilization. The front camera is an 8 megapixel unit, and it can capture some wonderful selfies for those of you into that sort of thing. The photos are bright, have great detail, and good colors. Overall, I think 95% of the population would be perfectly happy with this camera combination. But if you're looking for something to keep up with the Note 5 or V10, this ain't it. The speakers on this phone is one area that no other device manufacturer can match right now. And that's not just because the speakers are front-firing and stereo. They're plain loud. You can probably leave your Bluetooth speakers at home when you have this device and have a mini concert for yourself. Yeah. Say. These old sneakers, faded blue jeans, no tricks, no gimmicks. I'll be stomping down, 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 demons. Rolling up trees in the belly of the beast where the people disagree. The upper class, middle don't exist. Not only does music sound good, but so do games. I honestly don't play a lot of games on my phone. I'd rather play on a console that allows me to have a more full experience with the audio surrounding me. With the speakers on this device, I feel like I'm getting that full experience as well. Play a first-person shooter with the sound loud, and you might find yourself ducking for cover from Reflex. Battery has been pretty good. It's a rather large 3450 milliamp hour battery. I don't normally have the best of luck out of Android batteries. My use normally has me charging the device for a bit in order to get through a day. The 6P, I unplugged the device when I woke up around 5 a.m. I played a few games, watched a couple movies, listened to some music, and checked Facebook for the latest memes. And by 8 a.m. I still had some juice left. It's very impressive, and the doze feature works great. I didn't think I left the device idle long enough for it to kick in, but looking at the battery graph, the flat points show me that it worked as advertised. I wouldn't be surprised if people who root and replace kernels on their devices were able to get 6 or 7 hours of screen on time. Absent from this year's Nexus line is wireless charging. I thought we'd see this become more of a thing, but since the outer shell is built completely from metal, it looks like we'll have to do without. Fast charging is present and it works really well. But then there's that darn USB Type-C. Type-C will probably be the industry standard in the next year or two, but right now it's a minor annoyance. Yes, it's nice because you don't have to worry about the direction of the plug, and it charges super fast, but having to replace all your current cords is just going to suck. We did it for Apple and its Lightning cords a few years ago, so it looks like it's Android's turn to shake things up. If you know anything about me, you know that I'm a huge Nexus fan. Every year when these devices come out, it's like an early Christmas to me. That being said, there are a couple FOH features that I have to talk about. Now, for those of you who don't know what FOH is, or don't remember, I'll pause for a second and give you a chance to go to Urban Dictionary and look it up. Okay, so I only have two for you this time, and both are a bit of a stretch. Number one is that there's no expandable storage. Nexus is supposed to be the phone for power users. Power users need expandable storage. We like tons of music, movies, and photos on the device. It's not that I don't want to pay for a larger hard drive option, it's just harder to transfer content. The second FOH feature, and yes, this is a stretch too, but the device is much taller than you'd expect. It's about a quarter inch taller than the Note 5, and the same height as the V10, which has two screens. Stereo speakers couldn't really take up that much room, right? This device is about Android in its purest form. A device that tells other phone manufacturers that less can sometimes be more. Should you buy it? Hell yeah. With the Nexus experience, there are no fancy gimmicks, no bloatware or carrier contracts, no split screens or using more than one app at a time, no stylus or secondary screen. Just a device free of clutter and smooth as a baby's tuchus. All of this has always been at the sacrifice of a device that leaves you wanting more. This year, that is no longer true. We are finally given a device that feels like it's worthy to carry the entire Android market on its back. Sure, there are a few quirks here and there, but the overall experience is an Android fanboy's dream come true. Anything that is lacking is probably going to be taken care of through software updates, coming directly from Google as soon as they're available, or apps that you could probably download from the Play Store to fully customize your experience. If you're a developer, this is definitely the device for you. If you're coming from an iPhone and you're looking for the smoothest transition into the Android world, this device is for you. But if you're looking for the most feature-filled phone on the market right now, keep looking as this isn't it. Stay tuned for more updates on this device, including software updates, and long-term testing. Please like and subscribe for more content. Thanks for watching. LG, LG!